Well, good afternoon, everyone. I am so happy, excited, just over the moon, jazzed about this opportunity that was provided for us by CTLA and ITT. Already, just being in the room means you're some of my favorite people at APU. That is a true story. And for me, it really is sort of the underlying purpose for me was to bring people who were concerned about the international experience, have a heart towards international students, want to find out more about international students here at APU. And so I'm really curious about who you are and the experience that you bring to the table. We're hopefully going to find out a little bit more about that towards the end of our time together. But I have a couple of goals for this time. One is to sort of give you a really, really brief snapshot of international education, both nationally and at APU, and that is going to be from a very high level. We're gonna cruise through very quickly. And then I want you to hear from my colleagues who are by far the greater expert than I am. And then obviously the stars of the show for me at all times, wherever, whatever I'm doing at APU are the students, and they'll lend voice to some of the experiences and the norms and patterns that we'll be discussing. So I am going to allow the team to introduce themselves. Again, my name is Leah Klingseis. I am Director of International Enrollment Services. And so I get the joy of traveling all over the world, speaking with school administrators, universities, churches, about their partnership with APU. I get to recruit students and then help with that onboarding process as they arrive here. And so I'm part of a larger group at the International Center. I've been at APU for 10 years, which is really astounding to me, because I feel like I'm still only 26, but never mind that. I was 8 years part of the Adult and Professional Studies Department, so I feel like I landed in a place where I'm constantly using my passions for underrepresented groups across the university, and so I'm really excited about that. I've only been in international about a little bit over 2.5 years, so.
Hi, everyone. My name is Chanyeon Kim. I've been going by Chan. I got too tired of spelling out my name. It means Korean. It means praise in Korean. And I am a junior in undergrad. My major is psychology and my minor in sociology. I was born in Korea, moved to Vietnam when I was 2, and then I went to a international boarding school in Malaysia for about 8 years, and then now I'm here. I've been in APU for about 3 years now. Nice to meet you.
Hello, everybody. My name is Mary Grams. I direct the Office of International Students and Scholars, and I got my master's here in TESOL many years ago. And right after that, I started working here, which I never assumed I would, and I have been here at APU for 30 years working with international students and scholars. So you can tell I kind of like this group of people. And as far as what the function of our office is, we basically, once the students are recruited and arrive, we work with them on their immigration process, their orientation, and they're kind of home away from home to come in and get, you know, cultural questions, et cetera, vocabulary. We just try to be present for them and provide a safe environment.
All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Steven, or my real name is Shi En Huang. I'm from Taiwan. I'm a senior studying in psychology. Growing up in Taiwan, and I've also been through a few exchange study program in Australia and Germany, but so far I very much enjoy the environment here.
Hi everybody, my name is Michael Chamberlain. I'm the program director of the American Language and Culture Institute. We're an academic English intensive institute, and so students who Leia and others admit conditionally, when they finish our level 4, they matriculate to undergrad programs, and when they finish level 5, they go into graduate programs. Before, I've been at APU for 16 years, and what else? Before I was at APU, I was working with political and business leaders, training international people for political and English for business purposes. So I've been working with international students for my whole career, and it's great to be here with you.
Welcome, everyone. Thank you. Thank you for being here. I wanted to say thank you before I introduce myself. Well, my name is Myung Hee, which means bright joy, and I go by Gina with the same reason as Chanyang. I finished my bachelor's degree here at APU last May. I did psychology for my undergrad, and now I'm pursuing a master's degree, CSCSD, College Counseling and Student Development. I am Korean. I grew up in China for 8 years, and then I came here to pursue higher education in America.
Okay, so this is what we're going to try and cover today. We're going to do a brief landscape of international education or international students here at APU. And then we're going to have a discussion. Really, it's going to end up being our sort of experiences for that first part. Hopefully, we'll move the other parts to the end. And then we'll look at the APU international experience through our four cornerstones. Okay, so that's how we're going to progress throughout this hour. I wanted to give you a really brief overview of international education across the U.S. There are over 1 million international students here in the U.S. And partly pertinent to our conversation is that the majority of them are funding themselves. Remember that international students come to our institutions without the ability to receive any kind of loans. No FAFSA, no Pell, no Cal. So they are out-of-pocket students. And in fact, at APU, they are not able to access need-based aid. So at here, they really are out-of-pocket students. You'll see that 5.2% of international students make up the student body nationally here. And so you'll also deduce then that we are below that scale. At APU, we're only at about 3%. International students versus the rest of the population. One out of every three international students that come to the U.S. study in California, New York, or Texas. And of those students, California is the top. We have about 10% more than everybody else. So we are a destination here at California. And obviously, China's a top sender nationally, as they are here in the U.S. STEM fields are the most popular, and they contribute quite a lot to the U.S. economy. And so I think this might be a more interesting slide for you. There's a total of 344 international students here at APU. These are predominantly F1 students, so these are passport holders from other nations that are here at APU. Graduate 137, undergrad 167, and you'll see our language school as well. Our director for American Language and Culture Institute, which is our ESL arm in the International Center, is here. You can direct some of your really hard questions to him because he's my favorite guy. And you'll see that we recruit about 120 students, brand new students, every year to APU. 50 countries represented here, and 86% is our retention rate from fall to fall. So it's quite high. Yeah, it's quite high. So what I do want to point out, though, is that you'll see that our top two sending nations, so we'll focus a lot on China and South Korea, you'll see that they make up over half of the international students here at APU. Taiwan and Mexico follow, but they're quite a ways away from China and South Korea. I want to give you a quick snapshot of the most popular programs, both on the undergraduate level and the graduate level. This is undergrad. You'll see business, music, psychology, and undeclared. I think nursing would be right up there if we had room for the international students that we receive in nursing, but the numbers that are in parentheses are the new students coming in. So those are the brand new students in those programs. For grad programs, you'll see nursing is right up there. Music, management, theology, and the MBA. So those are our top programs here at APU. But there's quite a diversity in the programs. I wanted to share briefly with you the study that the World Education Services put out. This is one of their research back in May of 2016. And basically, they surveyed about over 4,000 international students coming to the US. So I wanted to make sure that you had a little bit of a feel of what's going on in international education nationally. And so one of the more interesting things about their findings is really that probably on the third, the fact that most international students are really looking for research opportunities, intern opportunities. They come here because they're focused on their occupation, on their job, on their careers after. And also, please remember that APU is quite well known within the Southern California area, but overseas, when we talk to people about the schools, the school, we're really speaking to them about opportunities out by the time they finish their education. Another reason I'm involved in this as an enrollment person, not a faculty person, but as an enrollment person, is because I know this to be true. I travel all over the world for APU, and I would say 90% of the time I utilize an alum with me. In fact, I leave for Thailand in a week, and we'll meet an alum. After that leg of the trip, we go to Taiwan to present at Shui Ping University, and an alum will be with me the entire day. They will present, they will do their testimonial, and I have found that to be consistently true every country that I go to. And so if their experience at APU is great, they have that sense of affinity, they are very willing, more so than their domestic counterparts, very willing to be brand ambassadors. And that's kind of one of the key reasons I'm here today facilitating this. I also wanted to show you that nationally, the study is showing that international students have the same issues that they anecdotally have here at APU. Language proficiency, discrimination, they have difficulty with social connections, and they also cited homesickness. So these are things that Mary's group very adeptly helps them deal with, but we see that here at APU. And then they also cite that the most lacking services that they experience nationally are career services, again, going back to the reason they came to study abroad, housing, and finances, institutional aid. They simply do not get as much aid as their domestic counterparts. Okay, so every culture class you've ever taken probably put up a scale, you know, the 5 scale and where you are in the spectrum. I wanted to kind of give you a really quick snapshot of what's been informing my work lately. And it really is this book by Erin Meyer. She is a director in INSEAD, and that is one of the top global international schools. They're ranked number one internationally as a graduate global school, and her research has really informed some of my thoughts around this. When the scale, as in regards to the scale, I like her scale because it's more nuanced. And she really talks about this idea of cultural relativity, meaning what's the distance between my culture and yours, as opposed to putting people in boxes of, you know, you're linear and, you know, that sort of thing. It really is the proximity between your culture and mine. Obviously, she does something with communication, low context. It's important to state here that the US culture is the most low-context culture. Her research shows that we are the most low-context culture in the world. We are implicit, we are direct, we rely heavily on our verbal skills, right? Whereas, I will show you later that some of the cultures that we serve here, predominantly at APU, are very high-context. They're more nuanced, they read the air, they focus on some of the more nonverbal parts of communication. And so we will definitely have challenges in that arena. How do we evaluate? I find this to be interesting because in my own work in the classroom, you know, I grew up in the U.S., came here when I was 11 years old from the Philippines. So most of my education's been in the American culture. And so I have been taught when you are to give feedback to someone, to a student, you tell them what they do well first, right? And sometimes even in my communications class, when I'm in a group and we're about to give feedback to a student, we say, list three great things, right? List three things that you found compelling about that presentation, and then give them something they can improve on. Very American. Very American. So people on the more indirect side of feedback are looking at that going, okay, well, then you loved me. You loved what I did. I was perfect because you told me I did this well and did this well and did this well. But, oh, there's this little thing about organizing my speech over here. But that's no big deal because you told me all these awesome things about me, right? So it can tend to be confusing. The persuading really has to do with whether or not we put application and use of information first, as opposed to looking at more conceptual and theoretical things as we present or speak to people. And then obviously going down, you know, leading, deciding, how do we decide? Are we top down? Are we consensual? This is huge for me in my work. The trusting, because the U.S. is also one of the most task-based cultures in the world. We build trust. Think about the people that you trust in the faculty or in the staff. You probably trust them because at some point they did something well for you. They helped you accomplish something. Whereas I'm working with highly relationship-based cultures, right? So I'll go visit a school and I'm thinking we're gonna cover point A, B, and C. But no, we're gonna have tea first. And then this evening we'll have dinner. And then the next day I'll meet, you know, a few other people. Some of the students will speak. And maybe at the tail end of the trip, 5 minutes into it, we'll talk about what I wanna talk about, which is, can we partner together to help get students at APU? So it's a very interesting concept that she's come up with. So I just wanted to recommend her to you if you want to look at something of the culture scale. And you'll go on to look at that. What I did on this next slide for you is to really look at, I mapped out the American culture and the cultures, the two cultures that we predominantly serve here at APU. So you'll see that the places where we might have, that will be highlighted in some of our conversations here today, that where we might have most difficulty are the places where we are really on opposite sides of the scale. In fact, I'm gonna hand it over here to Chanyang, who's going to share her own APU experience with you and share with you some of the norms that she may have had difficulty with as she came to APU.
So I'm just gonna briefly talk about the leading side of it. As you can see, Korea is at the very end of being really hierarchical society. So that like affects the way I perceive and the way I interact with the professors and the staff members at APU, because I see them as being higher up than where I am, and that means that I don't call them Mary, I don't call them Leah, I'll call them Miss Graham, or I'll call them like proper terms. And like at APU, the focus is very much on like, come to my office, we will have tea, we'll talk about your life story. If you have any questions, always come in. But it's really, really difficult as a freshman incoming student to approach, take the initiative to approach the professor. So I was talking to Gina yesterday and like laughing about this. So in my freshman year, I would like, if I had a question, I would sit there for like 10 to 15 minutes and try to like formulate my question, like word it. It's like I have like five different ways of how to ask the question. And then I'll try to go into class and like raise my hand. I'll get too intimidated, so I'll try to stay behind to ask question. I'll get too intimidated. I'll be like, oh, I'm just gonna email the professor. And then I just leave the classroom. And I also, like, one of the first appointments I made with my professors, I would, like, rehearse what I'm going to talk about for, like, half an hour. So it's really intimidating at first to be able to approach the professors and staff members because we come from such like hierarchical society. So I think like it's and even for me, like I don't have an issue with my English, so it wasn't as that big of a jump for me. But I could imagine people, like students who struggle with English, for them to overcome the language barrier and overcome the cultural barrier, it's really difficult at first. But you guys are all really friendly, so we overcome it eventually, I think.
Anybody else want to share down there that?
Sure, I can go talk about disagreeing. So as you can see, South Korea is towards the voice confrontation, and this can apply to, like, for example, discussion during class time. So when we have discussion, and if I have something that I don't agree with the professor or even with classmates, like I will fear or I will worry that I might hurt someone's feelings when I talk about my own idea. So I would just end up not saying anything and telling myself, it's okay, I'll just keep it to myself. And yeah, that will be most of international students' way of participating in class. So yeah.
Yes. I want to introduce Hector really quickly. This is Hector Vega, who is our, he's a worship leader for International Chapel. If you've visited International Chapel, he's a leader in the international department. And so we asked him to lend his voice as well. Hector, maybe you can tell them what year you're on and what you're studying.
For sure. Hello, everybody. My name is Hector Vega. I'm an international student from Mexico. And I'm studying music, audio recording, that's my major, and I'm in my final year here at APU. I might do an extra semester, but yeah, this is where I am right now. And I came here as an AOCI student. AOCI is the English program for APU.
He's my former victim.
He broke my legs many times. he's an amazing professor. So I came here not knowing English, and he is the witness.
Sorry, did you have something to add, Stephen, or you're good?
Oh yeah, I'll just piggyback on what Chanyeon and Gina said earlier. Giving it two examples, one within the confrontation. It actually just happened last week in class where I have a question in class. I raise my hand, I ask the professor. Somehow our communication seems to not really connect in between, so he ended up answering not what I was trying to ask. And he went through 2 to 3 minutes, give or take. By the end, I smile and say, yes, I'm satisfied with it, because I don't want to proceed more and take up more time, even though the professor actually did not really answer my question. And luckily, that professor actually pointed out, it's like, do you really know, or are you just being polite? I'll talk to you later. Yeah. And another example of being in class in Taiwan, we usually not even talk to students. We don't even talk to teacher as much. Given an example, sometimes if you raise your hand in class, the teacher would just say, ask later. Later, which usually never happens. So there's not a lot of communication. All we are asked to do is sit, listen, and memorize.
So I want to speak to that whole I'll talk to you later, because even now, as a 40-year-old, I still have a hard time when I'm in meetings at APU, still have a hard time interrupting people. And you know, when we're having a discussion, even though it's very pertinent and I have a very distinctive point of view, sometimes I will go back to my office, type it out, and send it. And I've had folks really come back to me and go, why didn't you add it at that meeting? And I was, there was no opportunity to. And so it's interesting, because even now when I'm in meetings with groups of people, I have to really be intentional to tell myself, you have a valid point of view, go ahead and interrupt or say, excuse me, what about this? But it never feels good to me. Isn't that strange? So it's something I'm intentional about, but it never feels good to me to do that. And so I want you to think about even how we view student engagement in the classroom. When I've taught previously, when students are excited and interrupting each other to give their point of view, there's an energy, a sense of synergy in the room. And you know, some of these cultural studies have made me sort of step back and go, well, I could have very engaged students, but they're not, you know, sort of raising their voices and giving their point of view in the midst of the classroom. It always feels better to me to be asked what my opinion is. So just something to think about. Okay, so what we're going to do next is to look at specific APU cornerstones and programming and how international students might approach that or might have difficulty with some of those things. And really, all we're doing is we're wanting you to think about some of these issues. We know, you know, when we looked at student thriving, we were sort of like, wow, that's a big ask. For us, this is scratching the surface, helping you understand some of the experiences, and we hope it's an ongoing conversation. So giving it to my colleague here, Mary Grams, to discuss two of the cornerstones.
I want to start by also addressing the thriving point, because as I look at what thriving, and we can go on in a discussion about what that means for quite a while, but my take is, can we truly thrive in life without God? And yes, we can reach certain levels of, you know, of achieving and doing good things, but true thriving comes through our relationship with Christ. And the reason I bring that up is because the statistic, and it's there, is that 43% of our international students are non-Christian. And so as we approach the topic of thriving and Christ being the first cornerstone we're going to talk about, I have to say that I approach this from eternal perspective. I love APU. I love the fact that we can speak freely here. I love the fact that we invite people of other faith traditions or no faith traditions here, because it gives us an opportunity to truly follow Christ's commands, to love other people, and to make him known. I do believe there are many barriers here at APU as well, but the Holy Spirit is greater than any barrier. But I think for our purposes, we need to know what some of those are so we can help to override and be conduits. One of the first is Christian vocabulary. We often are tossing around words, redemptive, grace, mercy, sin, and even the name of Jesus hasn't been known to everybody who's come to APU. And as we use those terms, and I'm not saying we don't, I think we need to be aware that we have an audience of people who have no real understanding of those words. I think that also goes along with the concepts that we breathe and live every day. We look at things from an eternal perspective. We have a lifestyle that we look at love in the true meaning of agape. We look at the Holy Spirit. We look at a lifetime of service. And those things are very Christian worldview. And as we go about setting these cornerstones, and one of them is service, and we'll touch that in a minute, those aren't necessarily other worldview concepts. So we're putting individuals who are not of the Christian faith with additional challenges here at APU, along with regular Western and dominant cultures, et cetera, et cetera. Our Bible classes are almost impossible for some without those backgrounds of information, and I have for years been saying, why don't we have a meta-narrative class that counts, or more than one? You know, what can we do to lay basic foundations? I think those are important things. So our Bible classes, chapel requirements, although many of the students will say, oh, I can tolerate chapel because I can just daydream. But that's not kind of the purpose of chapel. So that's the reason we created an international chapel on Fridays, so that we could bring language and culture, other languages. We sing in different languages. We do cultural traditions. We try to present concepts about God without using all of the vocabulary. And we try to build a community that is very interactive, which is far more culturally appropriate when community is such a key, and not the kind of community that we maybe look at as community. So assessing our own cultural values is a very important. What do we look at as community versus other cultures' communities that go far deeper often than what we're accustomed to? I also believe, and I know Chanyoung touched on that, is the whole educational situation. We think, okay, well, if they're curious, certainly they can ask questions. They can ask what that word means. They can ask what the context of that means. But as you've heard, that is not a comfortable situation, especially when you know nothing and everybody else around you seems to know a lot about it. And that would be a very shameful thing as well. So I think those are some of the things that we face. Some will say, well, we have unchurched people here in America as well. And that may be true, but the unchurched here is far different than an unchurched from a country like China, where you don't know on every corner or hear words that are related to. I mean, our culture whispers less than it used to the undernotes of the Christian worldview, a redemptive process, those things. But that's not what many cultures are coming from that we are having. Now, our Korean students obviously have an understanding, many of them, because their culture has got a stronger population of Christianity. But again, these things we are able to overcome them, but that is just some of the challenge, along with faith integration courses that we are all to put in to write papers. And we're going to get to have Stephen speak to us in a minute about that. We do have people of other faith traditions as well. Probably one of the most challenging are those when we have Muslim students. You know, we talk about one God, but our one God is really three. It's not one God, and so that's just an off-put right there. You know, three in one, that whole concept just does not flush out. I've had numerous students come and talk to me about how other students come and tell them they're going to hell. And what do they do with that information? And they're in tears. We have, of course, morality is a big thing in some other religious traditions. The woman is very modestly dressed. And then they're seeing what they're seeing on campus is very incongruent to their concept of what a faith should be. Of course, our Hollywood influence in Southern California isn't that helpful either. It's quite strong here, which I noticed. I came from the Midwest and I'm like, whoa, what is this? So if I felt that, I can only imagine what our international students, and some come with the impression that we are a Christian country, and therefore the movies are showing Christian values. I've had that expressed to me as well. So it can be very challenging for a student who's come with the mindset about Christian, if they even have one, of the different faith traditions. I touched a little bit on what U.S. culture, how it influences the idea of community. I think that what we need to examine is, how does the U.S. culture impact Christianity here? And I think, as I have traveled around the world as well, I have seen culture influencing the Christian worldview in every culture. So we're not the only one, but if you look at clearly what the kingdom culture is, and then what our culture is, and often we say, well, we started as a Christian nation, and therefore, you know, these things, but I think we need to be very careful, and that it's a good examination of us to look at really what is. I find our culture very materialistic, and that is in the church as well. You know, that's my perception of Christian here, and I could go down to other countries, but I'm going to cut mine short because I think it's a value to hear from Stephen. And Stephen, when he came, and I remember him as a freshman, he was in my beginnings class, he was not a Christian. And so he's had quite a journey as a senior. He is now a follower of Christ. But going through that, and I'll just let him speak to what the challenges were in the process for him.
Yeah, just to start with, earlier Mary mentioned agape. I don't know what that is. I'll look it up later. But yeah, as Mary said earlier, UBBL has always been one of the toughest things, especially a lot of times when a lot of seniors and juniors, or even just upperclassmen, when I came here, they told me, just get over with it, take that class first two semester. And I wasn't a Christian until my during my sophomore year or my late freshman year. So during that time, when I sit down in class and being the need to open the Bible and say John 2:23, I have no idea how to look up that. I will ask my professor, what page is it? Instead of like looking John and all that. So it's really difficult for me, especially when it comes to exegetical paper. Man, that's one of the most difficult things when our professor says, pick 1 to 2 verse, then study it. I was like, during that time, I don't even know what Trinity is. How am I supposed to study one verse and came up with 10-page paper? That was beyond my reach. Fortunately, there has been a lot of helpful faculties. I was actually managed to go through, not in like a very, perfect situation, but I managed to go through. But when I thought that, okay, the 3 UBBL class were done, it will become easier, but actually it turns out to be a false idea. Because after that, there's the senior SAM, there's many other classes. By the end, there's always this integration paper that we need to think of. And for me, now it's a little bit easier than before, but during my freshman and sophomore year, not really going through Bible a lot or really hear anything about it, it's a little bit difficult for me.
And if you have questions, you can ask him some things later. And I'll just briefly touch on the service component, because again, that is part of our Christian understanding of life. When other people may look at from a secular point of view, it's about acquisition of getting a good job, it's about financially doing well, getting a high position, because then I will have more power and privilege. So serving others can be a real challenge in that concept. And sometimes it's because, they come from countries that are so huge, and it's just not even, the population is over 1 billion. Like, why would you think about all those people out there when we have to care for our family? So those concepts are hard. And if they live or come from underdeveloped nation, just like, well, everyone's in this situation, or most are in our situation, so that's a challenge. So I would say it's a great eye-opener, and I think one of the best things that we do is Mexico Outreach, if the students will take the chance to go, because it's living and in community, and it's challenging, and yet I think it comes alive more than just, maybe going down the street or trying to figure out, how do I serve somebody? I don't know what that looks like. It's kind of an unusual concept.
So if you're already wondering, there is a difference between admissions policy in the domestic side and the international side. In the domestic side, we're a little bit more proactive about making sure that students are Christians or have some form of faith and openness to Christian worldview. In the international side, we take all faiths. And I will often receive a question of, do you ask them, do you tell them that we're a Christian school, and what kind of Christian school we are? And I always use, a group of maybe random things, like if I told you that you were coming to a school that was mostly into Santeria, or, some obscure religion that you may have heard about, is there any amount of explanation that I can give you that would give you any kind of a context by the time you arrived, if you have no concept of what that is? And we do have students, unchurched in the US is quite different than unchurched in a communist country, right? So in the US, even if you do not believe, you know what church looks like. you know what it means to get together. You understand, right? So there's no way to explain that to someone who is unchurched from a different country. So those are some of the challenges that we faced in these two cornerstones. Want to talk briefly about the cornerstone of community, because that's another significant challenge. As you saw earlier in the West research, those social networks are really difficult for international students. Now think about moving somewhere and having to replace all of your social networks, but then having the additional barrier of language and cultural norms and patterns that you are unfamiliar with. Think about going abroad and standing in front of a laundry machine or going to a grocery store and all of the writing is in a language you don't know, you can't discern. Think about you needing food, right, and going to a grocery store and all of the labels are in a different language. We have students that come here, mostly they arrive with Mike Chamberlain, Professor Chamberlain over there in American Language and Culture Institute. So it really is hard when we limit it only to language studies and not culture studies and not community support. You can't parse those things out when you're dealing with international students. It can't just be all academic. So I also, as we said earlier, most of the cultures, China and Korea, are very relationship-based. So how do we deal with those differing perspectives of hospitality? Right? Hospitality means we've eaten together. You have fully seen my face. You know, you see me. And the fact that you see me means that that gives me confidence that you will do what is best for me. We are a very task-based culture, as I said earlier, and so the people that we trust are people who effectively and efficiently complete a task for us. But relationship-based cultures mean we're going to break bread, we're going to have lots of conversations first. I'm going to get to know something about your family and you'll get to know something about mine. And then at that point, I will trust you that I need to fill out this form. Right? So what does that mean when I go to One Stop? And I'm in front of a service provider who says, you have to do A, B, C, and D, and I have no idea who you are. What if you didn't even say hello? You didn't even find out what country I was coming from, right? So from the American perspective, well, for me, that's perfect. Yeah, I'm here, save time, right? I'm on the linear side of the scheduling piece. If you can get me in and out of here for in 5 minutes, I'll give you a cookie, right? But we have other students who are probably gonna be a lot more comfortable with you if you show that you care for them. Okay, so,
last week I had a Chinese student. She just graduated from high school, never lived on her own, and she was, you helped her out. She's in my class, and I'm worried about APA style. Okay, this is how you summarize, try not to plagiarize, and this is the homework you have to do. And then she's in the international center. She says, Professor, can you tell me how to pay my T-Mobile bill? And her, you know, so she's on her own. She's never paid a phone bill. You know, just a little bit of empathy at that point, because here I am just, okay, we got to get her up to speed here. And so I called Stephen over. But that's a little snapshot of what it's like, is that, all this APA stuff is great, but how do I do laundry?
Where can I get my quarters exchanged? So,
I mean, I think that's what the hospitality, and it goes a long way when whatever our role is, staff, faculty, fellow student, just to, you know, here's a young woman who's living away from home for the first time and asking her professor, because she doesn't know who else to ask or how to, of course, I'm no help. That's why I got Stephen to help. He's like, internet, phone, I can't do it. She goes, you can Bing, and I don't know. I'm a dinosaur when it comes to that. So that's a little snapshot of what Leah's talking about.
Yeah. So I wanted to give Chanyang the opportunity to give you the student perspective on this cornerstone of community and her experience.
In terms of community, I think, especially the freshman year, it's hard Because you definitely lack the social context and like the cultural knowledge about cultural norm. When you first meet a person, you don't like share your life story. You talk about like the TV show you're watching. You talk about what food you like. And not knowing what Super Bowl is, not having to seen any of the American shows, I definitely had a hard time of like, I don't know when to like how to get into this conversation because I don't know what they're talking about. So I think what I really found helpful was when my American friends either like explain what this is and take that effort to like, this is a Super Bowl, it happens every year, that helps. Or when they ask me questions and say, well, we are talking about the TV show we've grown up with, like what do you watch in your country or like what did you grow up with? So having that like extra, hey, here's a chance for you to talk. And that really helps me to jump into the conversation. And also in terms of community, homesickness is huge. I've been living away from my parents for like 10 years now, and I still get homesick. The first day it hit me really hard was when I first arrived, the first night I spent at APU. If you guys have ever like witnessed a new student orientation, they actually like put on this like huge welcoming, you know, you drive in with your parents and then everybody's moving your stuff together. But when I arrived, there was almost nobody on campus. They were still in training because we all arrive early for international orientation. So I got picked up by people that I didn't know. I was dropped off. I walked into my dorm and there was nobody in the dorm. It was a like empty dorm. I sat in my empty room. I'm like, I'm really excited to be in America, but this is kind of scary, you know? So like homesickness is huge. Holidays, Christmas, Thanksgiving. I don't know if you've been on like APU campus during Thanksgiving. It's like a zombie land. Like nobody is here. Like everybody went home and I'm here. It's like, I don't know what to do. And I didn't expect myself to be so homesick in America because I've been away from my parents for so long. But when everybody else is spending time with your family and you don't have a family with you in America, it's difficult. But I've had a couple of professors who invited me over to their house for Thanksgiving meal. I spent my Christmas this year with another American family in Idaho, and that helps a lot to have a company who would invite them over to their houses and build a relationship when I don't have mine over here.
Yeah. Freshmen are especially suspect to holiday homesickness because remember, they're coming without a car. They don't have a driver's license yet. So they're a little bit stuck on the APU campus. We don't often think about where they're gonna go for Thanksgiving. Another huge issue is that we close our dorms at Christmas time. So where do you go? If the plane ticket is $1,000 to get back home, most of them don't do that. So they are really left feeling pressed to make friends quickly so they can go somewhere because whether or not, we're closing our dorms for 3 weeks, right? So, I mean, these are things we don't really think about when we look at this huge cornerstone. How are we communicating community? So, and then Mike, you're going to cover this cornerstone of scholarship.
How many of you lived overseas before or learned a second language as an adult? Do you remember that process? How painful and difficult it is? Can you imagine studying at a university level or a graduate level? I think that kind of empathy is important. Most of my research has been with Chinese students. When I first came here, we had zero Chinese students, and now it's our largest population. Just a little thing, like I'm going to talk about scholarship, and I want to give some general tips from the University of San Diego, and then some specifics that I think might apply more towards the APU context. So the first thing is, seminars are really important, especially at the graduate level. A professor, let's say a business professor, says read this case and be ready to discuss it next class. And Stephen alluded to, maybe in Stephen's, I'm going to use you, okay? Maybe in his experience it was lecture-based, there wasn't a lot of give and take, but so the American professor sits in the front, puts his foot up and says, so what do you think? And at this point a bunch of Americans will start popping in, ah, blah, 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 blah. And then the next person says, I don't think you're right, da, 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 and it's so-and-so, and it looks like there's a big event happening. And in the culture, you're going to wait. I'm not going to overlap speech. That's impolite. Well, guess what's going to happen?
what's going to happen is you're not going to get in. Or you, why would you want to jump into this melee? And because I don't even know, because when the professor says, what do you think? It means, I don't want a summary. You already summarized it, and you've come up with your critical thinking, and you're going to present your case. And then there's going to be this little exchange. And it's part of the game, and no one's going to get hurt. But we know the rules to that game. But the rules that were played in another culture are quite different. And so there's a discouragement that happens that I never get to jump in. And the American professor's mindset for some is, okay, this student's quiet. That means he's not prepared, or he's not engaged, or worse yet, oh, his English isn't strong enough, when that's not the case at all. So I think just some of those considerations are important. When I talk to my students, I say the best part of being a student here is that you're going to be treated like everyone else. And the worst part and the most challenging part is you're going to be treated like everyone else. But the contexts are different. So here are some tips, and I'll just blast through these. Okay, I would just say be proactive about connecting with your international students, even a short conversation, because there's a high power distance for, let's say, in Chinese culture. It's not, professors don't talk to students directly often. And if you didn't do the work, that's too bad. There's not this developmental mindset. It's just not part of the culture. But for my students, when they talk about what means the most to them in the APU community is, wow, I can actually have coffee with my professor, or people care about me. So use that, develop that relationship. Try to pronounce the names right. Myung Hee, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
And
number two, normalize office hours. This seems like a small issue, but to let students know, I'll be in my office at this time, please come in, and it's okay to come in. I don't mind if you're here every week. It depends on what your values are. But for me, it's like I'm here to help you. That's why I'm here. It's normal to be explicit. It's normal in American culture to come in, and if you have a specific question, to deal with it. Because this feeds into other areas. Because if you can develop that relationship, maybe you have a student, you're going over a paper. Well, this person might have a different paradigm. And so invest in the first paper. Because if you spend that one, that extra 20 minutes, let me just talk about this paper with you. And use that time to teach what your expectations are explicitly, but also to develop a relationship. And then you can say, well, in class, feel free to jump in. I really want to, it's a value to the rest of the students here. You're a resource. And so that way in class, I already have a rapport and I can involve them, say, hey, Hector, what's your thought on this? Without putting them on the spot because we have relationship. Does that make sense? I think that's really important. But what you don't want to do is if I have a new student from Mexico and some of the Chinese students are talking about Trump, I wouldn't say, hey, what do you think? You're going to be the representative of all of Mexico. What do you think of the wall? It's putting the student, oh my goodness, I didn't know I was going to be the representative of my entire nation. I hope I don't blow this. So it's this balance. You need to have really good discernment of what, of, on one hand, you have a unique perspective that we want to include in the group. On the other hand, I don't want to put you on the spot. So number three, check in with students after assigning group work. We all know group work is evil. And you always know you have four people, two do the work, one's like a dead weight, and one's, that's true, right? One way to, and then sometimes in your classes, you might say, okay, well, boy, the Chinese students always do group work together. Well, I think it's important to understand the dynamics in the classroom, that maybe students in a group, they don't feel included by the other American students. And I think you can help set the tone to develop a culture where, oh, you're interested in online, business, and you are too, why don't you be intentional about setting up groups. And I always have a learning contract with my group work. I sometimes have a small group conference. And so I'll say, each group, before the end of the semester, just come in with your group and briefly tell me what your idea is in 10 minutes, and then who's going to do what in the group. That saves a lot of hassle. It's practical for any culture, I think. And it helps to set a tone and protect all the members of the group. Be conscientious about topics that presume a nuanced understanding of American history and politics. Here's an example. in China or a lot of countries, you have a central government, and Beijing is the central authority, and they tell Shanghai how it's going to go. But look at American system between the state and the federal. We still don't know who's boss. We argue about that. You can buy marijuana legally in a certain state, and the state police will leave you alone, but then the FBI will arrest you. These kind of issues are not explicitly understood by students. And I think the more we build relationship and become approachable and talk to these students, it's going to enrich our own profession as well. Aid is big. Provide examples of successful coursework. Tell them not to plagiarize it, but that's a joke. Maybe not a good one, but I think having like a resource bank of this is what an A presentation looks like. This is what a paper looks like. Having some of those resources for assignments, clear rubrics, are quite helpful.
Oh, I thought we were going to hear from Gina about her tale of two professors.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah. Okay, so I'll just briefly share my experience with two professors here at APU during my undergrad years. So one happened during my sophomore year. So I was a top student, even in my country. And I got fairly good grade even I got here. And then this one class, I was having a hard time because it was intense writing course. And even American students were having a hard time. So receiving a lower grade that I didn't expect, I was very shocked. And then being myself, I was trying to make an appointment with the professor, seeking for help. So I wrote her an email, and then we set an appointment. And I went up to her, hoping that she will give me some help. But all she said was, I don't know what you have learned from your first freshman seminar. And that was shocking too. And then she didn't really offer me any help to improve my English skills or even writing skills. So I had, for me being polite, I didn't want to interrupt her time. So I would say, okay, I'll go back and do my best and come back next time, which I never did. And I had the most, like the horrible class time ever after that. And on the other hand, this professor, he was, you can tell that he really cares about who you are, and he respects the fact that you are international and the views that you bring into your class. So if you are international in his class, he will ask, when he gives out a quiz, he will ask if you need questions on a sheet of paper. And then he just doesn't give it to you because he respects if you want it or not. So I really liked it. And the other reason why I really liked his class and his style of teaching was that he doesn't give a pity look to international students. And I think that's a really big on how you treat international students on your teaching. Because I think there's difference between empathizing and pitying someone. Mm-hmm. And I think as followers of Jesus, we should all know how to empathize others instead of giving a pity look. So that was my experience.
That's someone from a high context culture. So we may not even know we're giving a pity look, right? Because we're from a very explicit low context culture. So
one thing Michael mentioned earlier how the education here really works. I like to give another example of how we actually learn back in Taiwan throughout my whole life here. A lot of times we're given books, chapters, we read, we digest, and come to class, have a discussion. But in Taiwan, most of the time, the way we study for exam is we will have this thick of questionnaire, like 200, 300 questions that has been given throughout the past 10 years. We just do it over and over again until we memorize the whole question frontward, backward, and when it's come to test, we just do it. And we do it not because we understand it, but we memorize it. So, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Hector?
Yes. I really support all the ideas. It's great ideas that you guys can include. Something I would like to point out is we cannot expect to help somebody if we are not willing to invest and sometimes to lose things. And maybe during class, something that you will lose is time, you know? trying to explain an international student or making sure the international student is following. Probably if you spend 10 minutes every class, you know, and you only have a session a week, in 10 weeks you already lost a full session in time, you know? So we cannot just be willing and have the desire to help a student if we are not willing to sacrifice something. And also, something that I have always valued is when professors have understood my barriers and have respect my barriers and have been willing to help with my barriers. It doesn't take, I promise to you, the same amount of time for me to read an article 20 pages in Spanish than what it takes me to read it in English. It's extremely, you know, the difference. And besides that, I will not have to, in Spanish, if I read it in Spanish, I will only have to read it once. And notes are gonna be there already. In English, I will have to read it over and over and over to start making notes and start writing my paper. So if an international student comes and asks, can I get an extension, you know? It's not that we are not capable to meet a requirement, it's just that if you put that amount of time that I needed to read that article to the point where I fully understand it, with all the other articles that I had to read already for my other classes, you know? And then the amount of time that it's gonna take me to write, not that only that article, but the rest of the other articles, you know, you see where I'm going? It's just a long, long time. And sometimes you see the, actually, we see the international students we almost meet every week in one of the study room or something, and we go until the library closes, or we go until campus safety kicks out of one room, and we are really trying our best. So it would be very nice if there is a way where we can, as she said, no. Do pity, my English is not very good.
Yeah, pity.
But understand where the student is at and try to challenge him. We love challenges. That's why we came to a foreign country. We love to learn. And we are not here to be lazy, I guarantee you. That if we wanted to be lazy, we can stay comfortable. And so.
Tell us what you really think. Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah,
that's good.
That's good.
Yeah. Well, we are running out of time. Do you have something that you want to highlight from this next slide, Mike?
Okay, the plagiarism's an issue. I would just say, just based on what Steven said, I mean, I think that's a great illustration. Know that, like, Chinese, which is our largest demographic, the value of emulation is conditioned, and it's not stealing because you're assumed to write just from the master, and you don't have to quote. It goes without saying. So that's a no-no in Western culture. So I would just say be redemptive in the corrective process with that understanding. I think I always show them a Turnitin page, and I show them an example of plagiarism. Okay, you see, maybe if you have a noun phrase that's three words, because like civil rights violation, there's no other way really to say it in English, that's okay. But if you have a sentence that's 8, 9 words that are exactly the same, that's not okay. That visual aid is helpful. The second thing is the faith integration assignments are really hit or miss for a lot of people. Some of the students, for better or for worse, agents have helped them. They don't know it's a Christian school. They don't know what chapel is. They don't know what the Father, Son, and the other thing is. That's what, I'm not meaning to be blasphemous, but that's, I've read that over and over. Father, Son, and something else. And so it's called a faith integration paper. But I don't have faith. What about me? What does that mean? And what it turns into is I do some perfunctory thing where, okay, I'm just gonna write this verse and say something, but it doesn't mean anything to me. This is like my Marx class back home where we just played on our phones and didn't show up half the time because they have indoctrination classes in Marxism, in Leninism, in China. They have to take these courses and the professors don't wanna teach it, the students don't wanna take it. Faith integration must be that version of it. So I'm just going to do the assignment with an empty heart. but that's not what we're doing, is it? Or worse, they assume that it's an indoctrination attempt. And so, but a lot of students don't feel that way, but I just have a, say, what is your worldview and what's your perspective as a naturalist? I mean, can an atheist write a paper about faith integration of math and natural theology? How are they going to do this paper? Do you want them to pretend to be Christians? Because they can, or try to. They just won't say Holy Spirit because they don't know that one. You know what I'm saying? You have to understand they're here and they're trying their best, but be open and explicitly explain. If you're not a Christian or you have a different background, here's how other people have done it, and you can talk to me. My door is open. So that's all I want to say.
So we only have a really minimal amount of time, but we'd love to give you a chance to make a comment or ask a question, maybe share a strategy that's worked for you. Please let us know your name and which department you work in, because we are all really wanting to get to know you, and I know there's a lot of experience in the room. So if you have questions of any of the panel members, yes.
Stephanie here. And it's interesting that you brought up about the memorization, because my course is all about apply. I actually don't even put presentation slides up on the screen. I'll put a balance sheet, income statement, just let's just get to work. Like, I treat it like we are running a company and we have to analyze the business. So how do we help, you know, internationals who come from a memorization background to transition into that type of environment? And because I've noticed they are very good at memorization. Like, I can't even memorize like that, but they can memorize the entire, you know, every formula, up and down. Mm-hmm. Come into my office, they can memorize that book better. I don't even know what the book is talking about. They can break the book down because they have read that book maybe 10 times before the semester is out. So how can we transition or help them transition into an environment where it's very applied, because that's how it works.
Mm-hmm. Great.
I think I have somewhat an answer to that. For me, I would definitely say I would recommend that not to go as we are. That being said, it's not the question shouldn't change to become, so professor shouldn't adapt to us, but we should adapt to professor and that part. So it will take some time, but I think the first part is helping student or international student to understand what it is, to understand the concept. And instead of, if you give them the question and keep encouraging them to study in the old-fashioned way that they have used to. So it becomes a process that a lot of international students have to go through, which I would really recommend during freshman year and second year to adapt to a situation like this. And yeah.
I think the challenge before us is, do we adapt or do they adapt, right? And so hopefully we meet somewhere in the middle where real learning can happen. So, others?
Just a quick comment. Hector, that was the bomb, what you said. For saying you're not trying to be lazy, because in my mind, as you said, I'm thinking, you know, this is an MBA level course. Mm-hmm. You just gotta step up your game. You figure out those things, but you still got to produce the product. Mm-hmm. So thank you for, you know, bring me back down to earth a little, so I can be focused on the person.
Yes. So coming from a culture where it's very hierarchical. Mm-hmm. Sorry, I can't answer right now. What would be the? I'm a program coordinator. My name is Bianca Garcia, and for the CCSD program in Regina. And what would be the best way to, they approach me to get to a faculty member. What would be the best way to introduce them to the faculty member and encourage them? Because it's easy for me to be like in an email and be like, I see Janine on this email, go ahead and refer your question to her. I think I maybe dropped the ball on that and maybe was like, oh, now that I'm thinking about it, maybe it wasn't the right way to do it, but what would be the best way to do it?
Mm-hmm. I would say what you're doing is very helpful in a way that you are, I think the student will know that you are trying to help the student. And I think it's just like encouraging the student to come visit to the office. And I think that will really help to build the relationship. Yeah.
One of the things that I've found helpful in introductions, especially where there is a power differential, is to say something, you know, this is Professor so-and-so, they're really open to answering your question. Oh, Professor so-and-so, this is Leah, you know, she's one of our students from here, and, you know, she's really been, so a short and perfunctory culturally sometimes doesn't always work. Even when I introduce people, people always appreciate that I know something more than just their name and the question. And that has high value in some of the relationship-based cultures that we deal with. So.
More of a comment than a suggestion. After being in the States for 30 years, after coming as an international student, I ended up in a master's class here, and we were in a group, which I've never been a group type person, but in this particular instance, we formed groups, and sure enough, Lucci ended up with the four international students that were there. And it turned out that I ended up basically teaching English 101 before we proceeded with the management project. And my only concern was that the professor was inflexible. So what I got out of that is that I feel that this particular professor should have said, I understand that apart from having to explain the subject matter, you also had to explain what the project was all about. So I feel, and that's the only class where someone who was traditionally at the top of her class ended up with a B in that class. So to this day, I resent that the professor was inflexible.
So it's 1 o'clock, so let's thank the panel for email out the PowerPoint to everybody who signed in, and then this recording, once it's available, we'll also push this out to the community. Thank you so much for being here, and thank you, each of you on the panel, for being here.